welcome you to the service this morning. Let's all stand, turn to page 414. Page 414, trust and obey. Page 414, standing as we sing. Help this day. Father, thank you for the privilege it's ours to gather in your house today. We pray that you'd be honored and glorified in this place. We thank you for each one that is here. We pray, Lord, that each of us would know that we've gotten something from the Lord when we depart in really just a few moments. Lord, may we hear from you. May your word do its work in each of our hearts and lives. And Lord, may we have a readiness to trust your word and to obey your word. As always, Lord, if there are any among us that do not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, they're not a part of the family of God, we pray that you'd reveal to them their need for Christ today, and also that you'd reveal to them that they can be saved by simple repentance and faith. May they trust you. We pray for each one that is here, as well as those that are joining us online today. May you meet with each of us. Thank you for the privilege it's ours to be here. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for standing. You can be seated. Always grateful to have everyone in church, and always honored to have guests with us. If you're visiting with us today, I hope someone's given you a good acquaintance card already, but if not, we want to get you one. We have any guests like that that need one, didn't get one yet, you need one, shook your hand up, we'll get one to you. All right? If you'll fill that out and drop it in the offering plate when it comes by, we'd appreciate it. And if you got one, I assume you received a pen also. That is a gift from our church to you. Now we'll enjoy our choir.
Save us, thou art. down. Let's all stand. Turn to page 417. It is well with my soul. Page 417, standing as we sing. Attendance and attention to the meeting and attention to the Word of God. God was sure good to us, and we're thankful for that. Let's see here. Remember that teens, your bonfire activity will be this Friday, and if you're dropping your young people off here at the church, they'll be here at 4 and then picked up again at 9:25, or if you want to drop them off at the Moles Farm, they'll be 4:30 and 9, so about a half hour difference there, depending on where they're going. So look forward to that opportunity for our young people. Also remember that next weekend is time change weekend. We fall back an hour. Most people love this one, right? Gain an hour, so a little more sleep, that's right. So time change will be this coming Saturday night.
Also, in your bulletin, if you received the bulletin, there's also an invite in there for our, we call it the Potluck for Patriots, although we're not having a potluck this year because of the bid. But we will have a service on Thursday night, November the 11th at 7 p.m. here in the auditorium. Our school young people will be putting on a patriotic program to honor our veterans, current military personnel and veterans. We honor them, have done so every year for many years. Of course, we had to skip it last year, but so we're modifying a little bit this year. We'll have a patriotic program here in the auditorium. It's 2 weeks, or I guess 10 days from now, November the 11th. We'll move our midweek service to Thursday night that week. So I'm excited about the church being able to participate this year and seeing the program. It will challenge and encourage your heart. We've got a generation of young people that are coming. Amen. That have a heart for God. Amen. And a heart for patriotism, and it will encourage you. So much negativity and bad news around, it will stir your heart. I'm confident of that. And please invite, it's a great opportunity, church, to invite veterans and current military. It'll be a special evening for them. We'll have a gift basket for them, a small token of our appreciation for their service. And I'll preach a simple gospel message. It'll be a great opportunity to get folks in church. So avail yourself to that opportunity, if you would. All right, my dad will come and receive our offering.
All right, what a blessing to be in the house of the Lord. I've been reading this passage of scripture lately, and hopefully we'll get it in our hearts. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, sometimes we read over a verse of scripture and we know it, but we really don't let it touch our hearts. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, or that word love, it profiteth me nothing. But to think about our giving. But it means something to us, because it means something to others and means something to God. Let's have our ushers come. Ethan, will you thank the Lord this morning for the offering?
Father, I thank you for this day. Thank you for us to come together and worship you in your house. Pray that you help this offering to be a blessing to the ministries and the missionaries that we support throughout the world. Thank you for the wonderful meetings that we had this past week with Brother Sam. Thank you for the challenges that we received and the blessing it was to my heart. Pray that you do the rest of the service. Help us to get exactly what we need from the preaching, as well as to be a blessing to everyone here. Praise you.
Thank you.
Good to have her home for the weekend, or most of the weekend. She's got to head back this afternoon. Appreciate our college students. Always good to have them home on a delightful surprise, so in the middle of the semester. We're going to, let's do this. First, if you would go to 2 Peter chapter 3 and mark 2 Peter chapter 3 with something. We'll go there later in the message. And once you've done that, our text will be John, Gospel of John chapter 7. So 2 Peter chapter 3, and then the Gospel of John chapter 7. So when you've got your mark there in 2 Peter 3, if you'll go with me and join me in John 7, and then if you'll stand, if you're able, out of respect for the scriptures, we'll read our text this morning. Let's begin in verse 2, John chapter 7, verse 2, as we continue looking at the life of Christ. We see here in verse 2, now the Jews' feast of tabernacles was at hand. His brethren therefore said unto him, that would be Jesus' half-brothers, the children after the birth of Christ of Mary and Joseph. His brethren therefore said unto him, depart hence and go into Judea, that thy disciples also may see the works that thou doest. For there is no man that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself to the world. For neither did his brethren believe in him. Verse 10. But when his brethren were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. Then the Jews sought him at the feast and said, where is he? And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him, for some said, he is a good man, and others said, nay, but he deceiveth the people.
Howbeit no man spake openly of him for fear of the Jews. Now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, How knoweth this man letters, having never learned? Jesus answered them and said, My doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. But he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you keepeth the law? Why go ye about to kill me? The people answered and said, Thou hast a devil. Who goeth about to kill thee? Jesus answered and said unto them, I have done one work, and ye all marvel. The title of our message this morning is, What About You? What about you? Father, thank you for our time together again today. I thank you for your word. I pray you bless it to our hearts and lives. We know that it will not return void. I pray that we'd have a readiness to trust you and obey you. I pray, Lord, for your filling. We pray for your power. We need you. Our world needs you. Help us to see these truths this morning. We ask these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. You can be seated. We see in our text this morning that we've read several responses to the Lord Jesus Christ. As we view these responses, and we're going to detail them in our points this morning, I would that each of us would consider our own personal response to the Lord Jesus Christ, who he is. And I also want us to think about the response of those that you, I hope you have people that you're desiring to reach with the gospel of Christ. How are they responding to Jesus? Let me make a little bit of a rabbit trail here and say this. If we're presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ, someone's response is to him. It's to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's be careful and cautious that we don't take it personally from the perspective of they're against me. Now, we represent Christ, so in that we sometimes endure persecution, but their animosity, their anger is toward the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So how are you, how have you responded to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the gospel of Jesus Christ? And what about those that you are or should be witnessing to, sharing Christ with, trying to even bring back into fellowship with him? What about you? What is your response to Jesus? He is the Word made flesh and dwelt among us. He's the Messiah, the promised one. He is Emmanuel, God with us. He's a Savior. Now, Jesus certainly is everything he claimed to be.
Amen.
He's everything. He is all I need, as the songwriter said. Jesus is everything he claims to be. And as one family wrote, and they titled their family biography, He's everything he claims to be and so much more. Who is Jesus to you? I see, first of all, I want us to notice the family's response to Jesus. His family. We saw that there in verses 2, and it carries on to verse 9. Let's pick it up there again in verse 5, if you'll join me there. For neither did his brethren believe him. Then Jesus said unto them, My time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. The world cannot hate you, but me it hateth, because I testify of it that the works thereof are evil. Go ye up unto this feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come. When he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee. The Jews and Jesus' brothers, half-brothers, were going to the Feast of Tabernacles. This was one of many feasts that the Jewish community participated in. It was a week-long feast. It is described in Leviticus chapter 23 in more detail. But the feast was what would have been similar to our Thanksgiving feast. It was typically in the harvest time of the year. It was halfway between the Passover feast, so So about 6 months removed from the Passover time, which would be, again, we would, in our calendar, in our time, we would celebrate Resurrection Sunday around Passover time and remembering the Passover. The Feast of Tabernacles would be more like our Thanksgiving feast. It was a time to remember the providence of God in his deliverance of the people from Egypt and his provision and protection of the people as they first exited Egypt, got out of there, crossed the Red Sea, and even God's providence and protection and provision of his people when they were wandering in the wilderness of sin. They were wandering in a place God didn't desire them to be, but God in his grace and mercy still was protective of them and provided for them many times even against in spite of them. Aren't you thankful the Lord works that way today? Perhaps you're trying to say it this way. We know that once we trust Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, we'll become a member of the family of God. We're always saved, but aren't there people we are trying to win back to Christ? Trying to win them back to a right relationship with Christ as his child? Now, the story of the prodigal son is the story of the prodigal son. He's a member of the family. But he had strayed, he had gone wayward. And his dad desired that he would come back. We see that in God's relationship with us. He desires that we would come back into right relationship with him. And we as God's people should be busy about helping people renew their relationship, be restored in their relationship to God. The family's response here shows us some things. As they went up to this Feast of the Tabernacles, a time to remember the providence of God and his deliverance and provision for them. It's amazing that so many missed the Messiah when they were all involved in the religious practices that would declare the Messiah. It's an astonishing thing to really go to seed on in the Gospels. We're going to talk about the Pharisees in a moment. That they missed Jesus, whom all of these religious activities they were involved in focused on Jesus.
Right.
And yet they missed him. In our history, we have similar holidays. Now, many of our American holidays, by the way, a holiday is a conjunction of holy day. Is that correct? Conjunction? Is that the right term? I don't know. Not really. All right. Sorry. My grammarian, who I love dearly, gave me that look. No, that's not the right word. But a holiday is, why would we celebrate Thanksgiving? To remember the providence and protection of God on our founders.
Amen.
Our first president, George Washington, said, "The hand of providence has been so conspicuous in all this that he must be worse than an infidel that lacks faith and more than wicked that has not gratitude enough to acknowledge his obligations," end quote. If you can't see the hand of God in raising up this nation, you're participating in willful ignorance. And we'll describe that in a little more detail in a few moments. He also, George Washington, said in his Thanksgiving proclamation, "Whereas it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey his will, to be grateful for his benefits, and humbly to implore his protection and favor." Amen. It's a recognition of the providence and protection of God in our life. God is good to us.
Amen.
God has been good to us. And God desires to continue to be good to us. So this Feast of the Tabernacles was near the harvest time. They'd gather in Jerusalem. Many of them would set up temporary, places to dwell in, be similar to what we would do if you camp in a tent or something like that. It was a reminder of the wilderness wanderings. It was a week-long festive time, and the place would have been full of many, many people. It was a major event on the Jewish calendar, and masses of people would migrate into Jerusalem to celebrate it. It was a great feast. But we see that the family here was wanting Jesus to go with his disciples and make a name for himself. If you're who you claim to be, then Let's get with the program here. We see that his half-brothers were not quick to believe him. His own family, the psalmist wrote about that prophetically. They wanted him to go and show himself publicly. I would suppose that they were probably more than a bit weary of the brutal accusations that had been made against their mother about Jesus, accusing her of being immoral. Jesus Christ is virgin born, miraculously. Verse 5 states clearly to us that they did not believe him. Yet. In Acts chapter 1, we find that when the gospel was finished, they did.
Amen.
Notice what it says in Acts 1:14. Let me read it for you. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren.
Amen.
With his brethren. When did they continue? It was after his death, burial, resurrection, and his ascension. He had gone on to glory. Now they believe. They'd seen his death, his burial, and his resurrection. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ that will change people's hearts.
Amen.
Share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel works, friends. His half-brothers, his mother's children, would go on in faith. James would pen the book that bears his name in the New Testament. Judas, not Iscariot, would pen the book of Jude. We heard a wonderful message of the book of Jude on Friday night, didn't we?
Amen.
Perhaps you, like me, have been blessed to grow up in a home where Jesus dwells. I hope you have. That is a tremendous blessing from the Lord.
Amen.
Those in our congregation who were not blessed to grow up in a Christian home know how much of a blessing it is for you to have the privilege to grow up in a Christian home. But growing up in a home where Jesus dwells does not make you a believer in Jesus.
That's right.
Because his own brothers who grew up in the home with him did not believe him at the first. Do you know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Do you know him? When did you repent of your sin and receive Christ as your Savior? Did you know he dwells within you? The Spirit of God bear witness with your spirit that you're his child. And as a child of God, I hope you are a child of God. If not, you need to be saved today. But as a child of God, do you value your relationship with the Lord? Sometimes we who have had the blessed privilege of growing up in church, we discount our relationship with the Lord because it's just the way we do things. And you need to have a relationship with God. As we were challenged Friday night, we need to spend that time in the Word of God and know the book. By the way, we who are blessed to grow up in a Christian home need to be busy about winning others to Christ.
Amen.
Can I challenge you, moms and dads, with this thought, with this admonition, with this directive? Lead your family to be winning people to Christ.
Amen.
I think one of the things that our generation has missed is this business of making it a family event to win people to Christ.
Amen.
We schedule our soul winning and we don't make it our priority. You say, Pastor, that seems oxymoronic. Well, let me back up here. We have a soul winning time on Wednesday night, normally. Someday the vid will be behind us and we'll get back to these normal good habits. Soul winning time on Wednesday night before the evening service. So we as a family attend soul winning time. So we've got it scheduled. So certainly we make souls a priority. That doesn't mean you're making them a priority in your home. Let me share it this way. Who is your family praying to see saved? Who are you desiring to win to Christ? Who is it that you've gone after as a family? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What does that mean? We're going to be in church every time the doors are open. Hey, praise the Lord. Amen. I'm for it. Yeah. We're going to live with the church standards and try to please the Lord and be faithful to the Lord. Amen. I'm for it. What is the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ? It's the gospel.
Amen.
If we need to lead our homes into reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lead our homes in helping see people one to Christ. Lead your home in this business of winning souls. The second group I want us to see, we see the family. The second, the family's response to Jesus, what is yours? The second group I want us to notice is the Pharisees' response to Jesus. Notice verse 11. When the Jews sought him at the feast and said, "Where is he?" The Jews. Now verse 15, and the Jews marveled, saying, "How knoweth this man letters, having never learned?" All right, so there's a capital J there, and that is speaking of the Jewish leadership. So we would see the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, and so on and so forth. These would be the Sanhedrin council, Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes. These would be the leaders. They were the Jewish leaders, and they were always against Christ. I mean, for the most part, it was the exception to the rule for a Pharisee, a Jewish leader, to have faith in Christ and to be following Christ. Nicodemus is an exception to that rule. Joseph of Arimathea would be an exception to that rule. I'm confident there were more, but we know of those two that were named. Most of the Jewish leadership was absolutely against Christ. Although they had some very emphatic doctrinal differences, Pharisees and Sadducees. The Sadducees didn't believe in resurrection. They had doctrinal differences, and it would be more detailed than that, more than would interest any of us, I think, for the most part. They had doctrinal differences, but they were united in their hatred for Christ. They were united in their hatred. They were confederate in eliminating Jesus. They were what I would call the "I'm against it" crowd. No matter what Jesus was doing, they were against it. They were against it. I don't think they were happy when they learned of the feeding of the 5,000. I mean, can you imagine the coffee time the next morning with the Jewish leaders? Oh, how are we going to deal with this? You fed 5,000 people. This word is spread all over the place. I mean, it was in the USA Today. It was on CNN. It's everywhere. He's fed 5,000 people out of just a few loaves of bread. How are we going to, what? We, come on. Come up with something. We need some good footage to counteract what he's done here. We got to divert people's attention away from this. Peter walked on the water. No, we can just say all those disciples are following around with him. They're making up stories just like him, just like he did. No matter what good news came from Christ, they were against it. Listen, they were so evil and wicked that when Jesus Christ raised Lazarus from the dead, who'd been dead 4 days, their chief agenda, their chief strategy was, we need to kill Lazarus because too many people are believing in this Jesus. May I submit to you that in common man terms, the Pharisees, the Jewish leaders, were crazy. They were crazy. Yeah, preacher, I agree. Those guys were crazy. Don't be a pharisaical Christian. I'm for radical Christianity. I'm for people who are sold out to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But we don't need any more Pharisees in the family of God. People who wander around and they've found some comma in their Bible that demonstrates to them this new great doctrine, and usually it means they get out of being what they should be for the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're going to tell everybody how they're so much better than they are. I don't have to practice the faith. It's a spiritual exercise. Crazy. Yes. The Christian life is a life.
Yeah. Amen.
It's the way we live. It is a spirit. It is spiritual. It is a personal relationship with God. It is a spiritual life. But it is a spiritual life that is fleshed out. It's a practical life. It's living in Christ. Don't be a pharisaical Christian. The sad truth about the Pharisees is this. They're like most of the world today. They were trusting in their religion, and they missed the Savior.
That's right.
They were trusting in their religious practices, and they missed the Savior. I mean, you remember some of those pastors, I mean, they tithed of salt and pepper. These little spices, I mean, they would tithe. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, good night. You think when I hit on tithing, it's rough? Well, did you tithe on your salt this week? Did you salt? I mean, spices, they were obnoxious about these things. They missed the Savior. They thought it was in the activity and not in a relationship with God, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. They trusted their religion rather than the Savior. Rather than admit that the Word of God is the inerrant truth, they unreasonably led the mob to murder Jesus. He was perfectly innocent. Rather than trust him, they led the mob to murder him. I was encouraged, reminded of this truth again this morning. It was Bible truth that they rejected. They rejected the truth that they were given. These were the people who knew the law of God. Note that he said there in verse 19, did not Moses give you the law? And yet none of you keepeth the law? Woo! I mean, you talk about getting a Pharisee upset in a hurry.
That's right.
Who are you to tell me I'm not keeping the law? They rejected the word of God.
That's right.
You know, in that account there in Luke chapter 16, and I read it several times a year on purpose. The rich man Lazarus, rich man lifts his eyes up in hell, not because he was rich, but because he rejected the Savior. This is not a matter of economics. Coming to Christ is not a matter of economics.
That's right.
It's a matter of faith. Send someone. Send Lazarus to even witness to my brothers. I've got five brothers. Go tell them. What did the Lord respond with? If they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. I'm going to tell you, there's two challenges there of that to me, right? The one is this. If you're not going to believe the word of God, you won't believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you won't accept the word of God, you're not going to believe the gospel. That's the negative. But here's the positive for we who are believers. Just keep giving them the word.
Amen.
Why do we send nearly 30,000 Gospels of John and Romans to homes in our community over the last 9 months? Word of God. God's Amen. Word will not return void. We keep giving out the word. We need the word of God. Amen. We need the word of God. You and I need the word of God. We need to be people of the book. We live by the word of God. The Pharisees rejected the Bible truth that they had. Then I want us to see one other group here, and that is the people's response. We've seen the family's response. We've seen the Pharisees' response. Now let's look at the people's response. This is just the population, the crowd at large, if you will. We see that in verse 12. And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him, for some said, he is a good man. Others said, nay, but he deceiveth the people. This is where most of us live today. Some say he's a good man. Some say he's a liar. You know, you say, well, much murmuring among the people. It was, you know, they were all sharing messages back and forth on Facebook about what they thought of Jesus. And if I could zing you, then I was one up on you. I'm for sharing good news in every opportunity. I think we as God's people need to check out what kind of communication we're sharing with our social media. It might be a sobering exercise for you to look at your own social media feed over the last few weeks or months and go, if a lost family member went and studied my social media feed, are they going to be encouraged or discouraged? I know it's quiet in here, and it's all right. Maybe it needs to be. Your life is communicating a message. We as God's people need to make sure our life is communicating the right message. The right message. And that is the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You say, preacher, does that mean I can't have an opinion about anything else? No, that's not what I'm saying. But your opinion needs to be shared in such a way that it is not detrimental to the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're called to be salt and light in our world.
Amen.
The people's response was, well, some think he's a good man, some think he's a liar. This is what I would call the apathetic response. The apathetic response. It was an insincere response. Notice what it says again in verses 19 and 20. Did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you keep the law? Why go ye about to kill me? The people, the crowd, the population answered and said, thou hast a devil. Who goeth about to kill thee? You say, Pastor, did they say it that way? I think they did. Well, you've got a demon. Who around here is going about to kill you? You say, why was that insincere? Go down to verse 24. Judge not according to appearance, but judge righteous judgments. This is Jesus speaking. Then said some of them of Jerusalem, is not this he whom they seek to kill? So, when he said, you're not listening to the law of Moses, you're not believing this, why go you about to kill me? You've got a devil. Who's going about to kill you? Four verses later, when he's speaking truth, judge righteous judgment. Judge judgment according to the word of God. Why would this be this guy? Isn't this the guy they're trying to kill? In other words, we'll take it or leave it, depending on how convenient it is for me.
That's right.
If I can get my agenda passed, I'm for it. If he's going to start preaching at me, he's crazy, isn't he? Interesting, isn't it? They were insincere. Insincere. Jesus is Jesus. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is the Messiah. He's the Christ.
Amen.
He's God the Son, come in the flesh. He's everything he claims to be. Everything. He's all I need. He's all you need. The preaching of the cross, preaching of Jesus Christ, was to all that would listen, all that would hear. But you know, we noticed something among the Pharisees. There was, and among this crowd, and even among his family, there was, I call it, willful ignorance. You know, willful ignorance is not ignorance at all. It's a rejection of the truth. What do I mean? I mean this. If you're wrong, would you want to know it?
Amen.
Verse 17. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. Verse 24 again, judge not according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment. How do we know if our judgment is right? Right here.
Amen.
Right here. This is how we know if we're judging righteous judgment. Again, it doesn't mean we can't have opinions about things, but we need to know the difference between our opinions and between this is thus saith the Lord.
That's right.
Thus saith the Lord. Willful ignorance is a rejection of revealed truth. The word of God proves itself to the obedient. If any man, verse 17, will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. The more you reject the word of God, the more callous you become toward him. This fact about the word of God should help us realize how the Pharisees, who entertained willful ignorance, became so unreasonable. So unreasonable. We got to murder Lazarus and get rid of him because people are going to follow Jesus. Do you realize how unconscionable that should be to anyone who knew the law of Moses? Willful ignorance led them to a place they were so unreasonable. It's almost beyond our comprehension. We've got to be cautious and careful we don't do likewise. Go to 2 Peter with me now. 2 Peter chapter 3. Those who entertain willful ignorance become more and more calloused toward truth. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 3. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts. Let me pause here for a moment. All right. I would think we are living in the last of the last days. But the last days began after the resurrection of Christ.
Right.
Or the ascension of Christ. Scoffers, after their own lust, were living in those days. Would you agree?
Yeah.
Verse 4. And saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water. Whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. I want you to consider something. Was the Holy Spirit of God, through the pen of the Apostle Peter, giving us a preview of evolutionary theory in 2 Peter chapter 3? These scoffers are going to reject the truth. They're going to deny the world that was and the flood that happened. Isn't that what we're living with now? How could you believe the Bible? How can't you believe the Bible?
Amen.
That's right.
Yeah.
Verse 7. But the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. Beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. Listen, get verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Willful ignorance will lead to a callousness to the truth and bring us to a place of unreasonableness. And listen, this is not only true of that lost world out there. It's true of you and of me. People sit in good, independent, fundamental Baptist churches all across this land and do for decades, and they become willfully ignorant of the truth. They're not interested in reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. They become calloused and hard-hearted toward the things of God, and they are unreasonable. Why would we want to expand our church? I kind of like where I'm at right now. Why would we do this? Why should we stretch ourselves for missions? Why should we stretch ourselves to grow our ministry? We get cows, we get comfortable in our own cocoon. We're here to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Reach people for him. Jeremiah 29:13, and ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. So the questions this morning are these. What about you? Where are you with this man, the God-man, Jesus? Have you believed him? Oh, preacher, I'm in a Christian home. I grew up in a Christian home. Sure. When did you believe him? Well, I've always been a Christian. And when you, pardon me, I'm not being ugly. I'm being direct because I want to get your attention. You're not going to stand before God and say, I was born in a Christian home. That's not a Bible reason for you to enter into glory. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The only justifiable reason for you to enter into heaven is I repented of my sin and I received Jesus Christ as my Savior.
Amen.
Lord, I claim to Romans chapter 10, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I'm not worthy of heaven, but Jesus paid my sin debt for me. I've trusted him as my Savior. And guess what? The gates of heaven, if they're there, if you're standing outside the gates, I know we like to paint that picture that way. I don't think we're not going to be standing out there knocking on the gate to see if we get in. When you're absent from the body, you're present with the Lord. But for sake of illustration, if you're in Christ, the gates of heaven are going to be wide open. Come on in! If you've rejected Christ, oh, preacher, you got your way of thinking, I got my way of thinking. My way of thinking is the Bible way. What's yours?
Amen.
Judge righteous judgment.
Amen.
And if my way of thinking doesn't line up with this book, I want to know it.
Amen.
What about you? What about you? Lost friend, will you believe today? Would you come to Christ today? Christian, are you pursuing the lost for Christ? Are you pursuing the lost for Christ? Who are you pursuing? What are you pursuing? Do you have some souls on your heart that you're trying to reach for the gospel? Some souls in your mind that you're trying to win to Christ? A Don, a Wally, a Pat. Chris. A Joan. An Audrey. A neighbor. Who are you trying to win to Christ? Well, preacher, let me tell you about this mandate. Let me tell you about this government. I'm not against knowing what you know about the mandate and the government, and I'm for standing up for freedom and liberty and so on and so forth. But they're not my mission.
Okay.
Do you know your mission? Do we know our mission? Let me be very direct and blunt. Some of you won't like this. You can invest your life. You can invest your life in a good way in trying to preserve America, whatever you think it will be. We go back to these good old days. Listen, people without the gospel of Jesus Christ will not sustain America.
That's right. That's right.
America, in the good old days that you dream of, that historical, this is what the good old days of America. They were what they were because there were people with a moral fiber.
That's right.
That moral fiber came from the Word of God,
Amen.
From people who at least acknowledged that God is God. Amen. Whether they were saved or not, I know there's some argument about that, and go back and revise history is nonsense to me. Our founding fathers had flaws, just like politicians today have flaws, just like our fathers have flaws, just like we all have flaws. But there was an understanding that God is God and this book is the final authority.
Amen.
If we don't reach people with the gospel, what's the sense of preserving a nation?
That's right.
I'm going to run that by again here because I want you to think about what I just said.
Right.
If we as God's people don't reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ, what's the sense in preserving a nation that is desiring perversion?
Right.
We're preserving the freedom to be more perverse, to be more wicked. That's not the goal of a Christian.
That's right.
I'm for preserving America. I'm thankful. I'm grateful. I'm proud to be an American in a right way. I'm thankful to be an American. Aren't you?
Yes.
America needs God's people to get busy about winning people to Christ, seeing them follow the Lord in believers' baptism, added to the church. And what I mean by added to the church is not just somebody else's name on a member roll, but participating in the church,
Amen.
Discipling, growing up in Christ's likeness, wanting to reach others with the gospel.
Yeah.
Our homes need to focus again on winning people to Christ. What about you? If you're here today and lost, come and be saved. If you're here today as God's child and the Spirit of God has spoken to your heart, come say, Lord, help me to be a better soul winner. Help me to, I'm going to get a handful of people that I'm pursuing with the gospel of Christ. And help me, Lord, to lead others to do likewise, lead my family to do this. This is the mission of the church. Winning people to Christ. What about you? Father, thank you for our time and your word today. Lord, I pray that you would help me to be a better soul winner. Lord, we are justified in our concerns about the direction of our culture and our nation. Lord, if we pursue changing the culture, absent of reaching people with the gospel, we'll be exercising ourselves in a futile endeavor. People need Christ. Our world needs Christ. Lord, there may be some among us today or some who've tuned in today online that are in one of those groups I mentioned, have yet to receive you. Oh, I grew up in church. I know about religion. I've got my opinion. What have we done with Christ? Lord, if there are people that need to trust you as Savior, I pray they come and be saved today. Perhaps there are people in our congregation who have been saved but never followed, made a public profession of their faith by baptism, scriptural baptism, by immersion. I pray they come present themselves for baptism. Others, Lord, who see the need to join a local New Testament church and get busy for the cause of Christ in our generation, for such a time as this. Help us to go forward for thee. Take the invitation now, Lord, lead and direct. Help us to be responsive to you. Thank you for meeting with us today. We pray these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Let's stand together this morning.